Good afternoon to all of you. Children, it is a great day for all of us to have such a great personality, one of the great sons of India, to be online with us. Sir, actually, we are highly honored and pleased by your presence. Now, you see, we are indeed highly grateful to you for accepting and coming online to talk to our children on the topic India in Space. Now, I request our Honorable Ex-Joint Commissioner Academics, our Senior Consultant at the NVS Headquarters, to pay the formal welcome to our speaker. Over to you.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Ramachandra. I work with Navodaya Vidyalaya Samiti. It's a lifetime opportunity for me to introduce you to the students. Organizer can mute all, please. Yeah, students, please. Can you mute, please? बच्चे सारे म्यूट कीजिए. Children, it's a great opportunity for us to listen to one of the great personalities we have today. Dr. A.S. Kiran Kumar is Vikram Sarabhai Professor at Indian Space Research Organization, Bangalore. He is member of Space Commission, Government of India, and member Governing Council, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He also served as the Secretary to the Department of Space and Chairman, Indian Space Research Organization. Sir, you will be really happy to know that with the support of Department of Science and Technology, we started a project for promotion of girl children towards the STEM area. This project consists of inspirational talk, visits to the scientific research institutes, and preparation for the competitive examination, some tinkering activities, and also collaborative projects with the scientists. These are some of the activities which are taken over a period of 2 years. It is conceived. 1 year, last November, we started. We have started in 58 schools, including 8 schools in the tribal districts in the country. We have this scheme as away in Leh also. This is how the children are spread across. They will be really interested to know. We have been organizing the inspirational talks from various personalities. You will be really happy to know, sir. So some of the people who have given talk are Dr. Manju Sharma, Dr. Mailswamy Annadurai, Professor Rohini Godbole, Dr. Archana Sharma from CERN, Professor Catherine Blundell from Oxford, Balakrishnan Subramanian from Australia, yeah, Monash. Yes. Monash, and two of our alumni students who are now scientists, like Dr. Ashwin Dalal, who is in CDFD, as well as Ritraj Maswekar, who is in National Institute of Health. These are some of the people who have given talk. Dr. Anil Kakodkar also spoke just 2 weeks ago. Chandrima Saha. Like this, we have been lucky enough to get great personalities to talk to the children. Sir, this purpose of arranging this talk is to drive the children, actually, to give them the actual enjoyment of pursuing science. We have also found that the survey also says that the representation of girls is very, very low as compared to the boys in the science area. Therefore, we have been taking up this project. For 2 years, we are supporting. This project, of course, envisages end-to-end support for girl children from class 11th till they start the research career. So this kind of a support has been envisaged. Thanks to DST for permitting us to have this platform. our commissioner would have been very happy to be with you today, but for some emergency, medical emergency, he has just gone outside. Children, you will be really happy to know the guest of today is from a very remote rural area in Karnataka. He actually explains his own career, like he wanted to pursue medicine, but remained loving physics because of another great personality named Dr. Narasimhaiah. So that is how he explains, and then he continues. His contribution in ISRO has been end to end. I have listened innumerable number of talks on video. Today I'm fortunate to see him personally. I always envision that, rather feel that God is kind to have given him three eyes. He has led one of the great organization which is able to see both underwater, what is there inside the earth, over the earth, as well as, so a practical true Trinetra we have in front of us, who contributed for more than 45 years, 4.5 decades to the area of remote sensing, electro-optical sensors. He has been the various committees, not only in India, but also outside India, an internationally acclaimed personality as far as the space research is concerned. For me, when I see, I'm one of the great human beings I have seen, despite having 85 publications, having occupied the chair of secretary to the Department of Space, and having so much of coveted positions, sir is very humble. That gives a great perception for you how a scientist becomes a great person. He has been honored with, decorated with Padma Shri by the Government of India. Similarly, he has been awarded international awards. One of the great awards he has received is International Von Karman Wings Award. And he has also been honored with a French honor that's called Chevalier de Ordre National de la Legion d'Honneur. This award is a combination of, at a time, 5 degrees. It is the highest order of French decoration given to a person who contributes to the humanity at a great, as a great service. And you will also be interested to know that this award was started some 220 years ago by Napoleon Bonaparte. This is what the present day's guest is. I am too small a person to introduce to you. I don't want to stand between you and the guest of on today. Sir, I would like to bless the children with your talk. Thank you for accepting our invitation, sir.
Thank you very much, Ramchandraji, for this opportunity. And it's indeed a great opportunity today for me to be part of this program and talk to the children about the Indian space program and also how India has made a difference to the living beings of this country. Actually, I also remember just a couple of days back, we had the Teachers' Day where we all remember our president, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, who has said, when we think we know, we cease to learn. That means learning as a student, lifelong we need to learn. And the moment we think we know, we cease to learn. That's what he has said. So students and the process of learning, particularly in today's world, when things are changing at such rapid pace, we need to remember that learning is a continuing process and we need to be pursuing this all along. We also remember that just like we see the things because of sunlight, we understand the things by the inner light lit by teacher. Teacher transforms us, teacher inspires us and teacher elevates us. Similarly, as you pointed out, Dr. H. Narasimhayyan was a great individual and with whom I had opportunity to interact during my college days, had said, "A poor teacher complains, an average teacher explains, a good teacher teaches, a great teacher inspires." Oh. So in fact, just a couple of days back, the Teachers' Day event was there. So I collected some information on that. So I thought I'll just put it before we talk about today's activity. What I intend to do is, I would like to take the students through the journey of ISRO in making use of space technology as a tool for development in our country. How a new technology, which was actually brought into the country by a great visionary scientist, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. Probably many of you students will be aware that we conducted the birth centenary year of this great scientist of our country, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, who had said that our national goals involve leapfrogging from a state of economic backwardness and social disabilities and achieve in a few decades a change which has historically taken centuries in other lands. You remember that India got its independence in 1947, and in 1957, when the first object was put into space by Russians, an object called Sputnik.
Hello.
You are able to hear me clearly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are. It's clear, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. All right. So, in 1957, when this object was put into space, what Dr. Sarabhai did was he made use of his friendship with Americans, Russians, German, and French scientists, convinced them that we need to conduct research in India, in a place called Tumba, where if we conduct that experiment, it will be beneficial for the global community. So what he did, he convinced the government and the then Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, and then brought in sounding rockets in the form of kits. So he also did another great thing at that point of time. He convinced the Americans that they should allow us to borrow one of their satellites, a satellite which was built by Americans, and it was moved over to Indian longitude, because if you know, a geostationary satellite is one which operates in an equatorial plane at an altitude of 36,000 kilometers. Speciality of this orbit is, for a person from ground, it looks stationary, like it's a tower at a height of 36,000 kilometers. So what happens with that is, you are able to see one third of the globe continuously from this place. So if you are broadcasting some signal from that, one third of the globe can receive the signal. So what Dr. Sarabhai had done was, he convinced Americans that they should lend us a satellite. And during the year 75 to 76, India conducted the world's largest socio-technological experiment. What was done then was, like today you have direct-to-home television, direct-to-community sets were built by ISRO. It was set up in 2,400 remote villages of our country. And you can see in this slide some of the students watching a black and white television set in the village, one of the buildings. And through this mechanism, Dr. Sarabhai, whatever he had envisioned, that it is possible to make use of space technology for communicating information to the people, broadcast, etc. And this particular experiment was actually the first of its kind in the world at that point in time. So this shows actually how in different parts of the country this experiment was done. And another very interesting thing that happened was, like I mentioned to you, Dr. Sarabhai had to convince his scientist friends across the globe that in Tumba, near Trivandrum, we have a place which is very close to magnetic equator. And if at that place, if we conduct upper atmospheric research, it'll be beneficial for the global community. So he could bring sounding rockets in the form of kits and assemble it here. And the church, what you are seeing here, is the place where the first rocket was assembled. And actually to launch this, he had to convince the fishermen in that region using the services of this church bishop. And through the bishop's help, he could tell the fishermen that if you vacate this place and allow us to conduct an experiment here, one day in future, the country will benefit. Just as though to prove this point, from 1999 onwards, what India had done is, by virtue of its satellites operating in space, looking at the color of the ocean, and through the color, identifying chlorophyll, and through the chlorophyll, food chain of the fish, and then tell the fishermen in our almost 7,400 kilometer long coastline, where the fisherman has to go for catching his fish. And this particular information was being disseminated by Indian National Center for Ocean Information System. It is through this mechanism that India was able to provide to the fisherman specific information where he can catch the fish. To this, we added a new capability when we did our NAVIC satellite. And you will see in this small video how the NAVIC satellite's capability has helped the fisherman.
The Indian Constellation, a 7-satellite regional system, provides position, navigation, and binary services over the Indian territory and 1,500 kilometers beyond its boundaries. Among the many benefits of NAVIC, significant are a wide variety of services that the fisherman community derive from it. The mobile phone in hands of a fisherman talks to the NAVIC receiver using Bluetooth and provides him with a wealth of information that not only direct him to the potential fishing zone, but also ensures his safety at sea during times of bad weather, and also alerts him against crossing the territorial waters while at sea.
You are outside the international boundary and are unsafe.
ನೀವು ಅಂತಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಸೀಮಾ ರೇಖೆಯ ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಹೋಗಿರುವಿರಿ ಹಾಗೂ ಅಸುರಕ್ಷಿತವಾಗಿರುವಿರಿ.
Using a fisherman app, the fisherman can receive the information on potential fishing zone, which is nothing but the area where there is a dense concentration of fish population. Apart from identifying the potential fishing zone area, NAVIC also guides and navigates the fishing community towards this location. Thus, a considerable amount of time, efforts, and cost is saved, while at the same time, there is a good fish catch.
See, in this particular example, you can see one of the most advanced technologies of space, where building rockets, satellites, instruments, with that, a fisherman who does not know reading or writing can also take advantage of this technological capability. The mobile in his hands, it does not have any connectivity to the terrestrial tower, because when he gets into the ocean, few kilometers, there is no terrestrial tower which will be in communication with the mobile. But then our NAVIC satellites passes specific information to him in terms of messaging and also helps him locate himself. So through an app on the mobile, in his mother tongue, he gets the information, and also in the form of a video compass, it navigates him to prospective fishing zone. There are also small gadgets like this, which helps him communicate to the coast guard and others to tell them in case he is in any distress. So in this manner, what Dr. Sarabhai had envisioned with the help of the fishermen, asking them to vacate that particular place for the initial experiment, ISRO was able to provide to them their livelihood support information using this technology. Similarly, using satellite technology, another very important thing that happens in our country is that today we are able to look at India. Every 15 minutes, you are able to see what is happening over the Indian subcontinent. This is by our INSAT 3D satellites, and each one of them covers the entire country. And using such images, cloud cover, and also temperature and humidity information, this data goes into the numerical weather forecast models of India Meteorology Department. And through that, the country is able to generate specific information on how we can actually deal with the cyclones. And even in the presence of super cyclones, we are able to give early warning to the disaster relief agencies, and through them, it gets into the disaster mitigation activities where they will evacuate from the place where cyclone is likely to hit. And this alone saves between 15 to 20,000 lives when super cyclones occur. And today we have a communication capability of a number of satellites, the INSAT series. First generation, we started building from the commercially, but INSAT 2 onwards, all the satellites are being built indigenously. And navigation satellites, like we mentioned already, is again an intrinsic capability. What we have done very differently from what was done by others. Many of you may be aware that a GPS system built by Americans, Russians, Chinese, and Europeans requires between 24 to 32 satellites. And then we have built with only a 7 satellite constellation such a capability. And today, using this, we have a host of applications which are coming up. And by virtue of satellites operating in space, we can look at Earth and then look at in different wavelengths. And using these different wavelengths, we're able to get information about whether what are the crops that are being grown, or which place you need to drill bore wells, or what is the yield of different crops that are existing, digital elevation model, and we can generate submeter images. Similarly, in meteorological applications, like I showed you INSAT data, we also have microwave sensors, because many of you will be wondering, in the months of monsoon, September, when you are looking from Earth towards the sky or from space towards Earth, cloud cover, the monsoon has a lot of cloud over India. So during the cloudy period, how can we see anything from space? But like we can see through glass in a transparent manner, microwave signals can see through the clouds and we can get data. In addition to that, you also would have heard of active imaging. That means when you take a camera and take a picture using sunlight, the camera acts as a passive device. It makes use of the sunlight as a source. But during night, you make use of flash. So that means flash acts as a source of light. Microwave sensors in a similar manner carry their own source of illumination. They illuminate this Earth, and then reflected and scattered signal is used to generate images. Today in India, we have a huge number of these observation capability, digital elevation model, and computer models. Using all this, we are able to provide to the different departments, Forest Survey of India, which conducts every 2 years, the forest cover of India, Ministry of Earth Sciences, potential fishing zone, Ministry of Agriculture, makes use of it for 11 crop sites, where it is able to tell the government before harvest what is the yield this year of the sugarcane, rice, jute, wheat, and many other such crops. Water Resources Department gets information about surface water mapping, and Civil Aviation Authority makes use of NAVIC-based system for the aircrafts, which are using this data for en route planning as well as for landing. For doing all this, we started with sounding rocket in the form of kits. We built satellite launch vehicle, and gradually we have built launch vehicles which can carry up to 4,000 kilograms into space. And today we are among the very few countries in the world which have an end-to-end capability of building launch vehicles, building satellites, and launching them into space. Not only that, making use of these launch satellites into a host of applications which makes a difference to the daily lives of our fellow citizens. See, here again, you see, we started with PSLV. We went on improving its capability continuously. And you will also be happy to know that this particular launch vehicle is considered as one of the very reliable launch vehicles. And a couple of years back, when it launched 104 satellites in one go, the entire country and entire globe turned around and looked at India.
Logistically, on 15th February 2017 at 9:28 hours IST from SG Siddharth Harikota, the Space Bank of India. Ground stop on submitted.
You are seeing pictures taken by the launch vehicle itself as it is moving.
Heat shield separated.
So heat shield is a thing which actually protects the satellite during the period launch vehicle is crossing the atmosphere.
Second stage separated.
PSLV is a four-stage vehicle. So what you are seeing is one stage at a time. You drop off them, because after their work, they become dead weight. So you lose that weight by separating.
Cartosat 2 series spacecraft injected into orbit. Two ISRO nano satellites, INS-1A and 1B, are injected into orbit.
You can see from the launch vehicle when you are taking the picture, Earth is there on your right side.
Sides, one after another.
So you can see 104 small satellites being put into the orbit by this particular launch vehicle. And in fact, you will all be extremely happy to learn that this became sort of a world record where in one single launch, 104 satellites were put into the orbit. And you can also imagine that the launch vehicle, the fourth stage of the vehicle, which is moving at a speed of 7 kilometers per second, every few milliseconds or multiple times in a second, it releases these other satellites and makes sure that they don't collide with each other, they go smoothly, and then subsequently they get into their operations. So this particular video shows the launch of all 104 satellites. Similarly, we have geostationary satellite launch vehicle. PSLV could put satellites into up to 1,000 kilometer orbit, or for even lunar orbit, or for the Mars orbit, smaller weight satellites. But geostationary satellite launch vehicles put satellites into 36,000 kilometers at up to 4 tons or 4,000 kilograms. See, while you are building these capabilities, you also need to develop capability for future. So some experiments were conducted where the supersonic test of scramjet engine was done, and then reusable launch vehicle was done. And also currently work is progressing for carrying Gaganauts from India into space and bringing them back safely. So you will see some examples of how space technology is being used today. Railways, for example, makes use of the satellite technology and Navic capability, and the vehicles can be continuously tracked, and control centers get to know where the train is at any given point of time. Recently, some of you would have seen in the newspapers, railways saying that they're able to improve their efficiency because of these improved capabilities which they have adopted. And they have also started using it for unmanned level crossing areas where they can give hooters and alerts light by the flashing lights and then hooters in the vicinity when trains come close to the unmanned level crossing. And also coast guards get information about the distress of the fishermen when they are in the deep sea. So all this capability is being built in and the satellites are providing. Today, like I said, microwave satellite is one of the satellites which are aircraft. You can see the kind of images. These kind of images can be taken day or night, cloud or rain. So that's a capability that is there. Similarly here, you can see that what you are seeing now actually is the kind of information you can collect over any part of the globe, South Pole, North Pole, or even over the oceans. You can find out what is the specific information about the wind vectors. And this information can be used by numerical weather forecasting for various prediction activities. And you can see the fly-throughs that can be created of very remote places, whether it is Himalayan region or other areas of interest. For all this, you have got today capability from space, and the kind of data you can collect are examples shown in this particular slide. In addition to that, you will also be aware that today India is making use of solar energy, creating using solar panels, and using satellite data collected over many years, you can find out which are the places where if you put a solar panel, you get maximum benefit, because at that place, sunlight will be falling for more hours in a day or more hours over an integrated in a year's time. And such information can be generated, and also ocean winds, wave energy, all this information can be collected from satellite data. And then here, for example, air quality monitoring. You can see when from space, when you look at when from the Gulf, the dust storms start, they go across to Mumbai and the western parts of India. And you can study this using the satellite data. Similarly, you can see how one can do image processing to improve the quality of the image. And here you can see how the ocean wind vector information is getting generated. And then Arctic and Antarctic region can be studied. Here you can see one of the iceberg close to the Arctic, Antarctica, breaking up. And then you can see how things happen over a period of time. And then here is again another example of, you can see here, this is the water that is getting collected because the glaciers are melting with time. And because of this, by studying data collected from the satellite year after year, you can see how it is progressing. And in future, how it can cause problem is can also be studied. In fact, the great heritage of India is the knowledge that we acquire, the technological skills that we acquire should be used for benefit of not only ourselves, but also to the other neighboring countries. India built a South Asia satellite and provided communication capability to many of our neighboring countries. And this is one such satellite which was built by our country, and the capability extended to our neighboring countries. While all this was being done, ISRO also continued to work on space science experiment, because it's only the science which can give us new knowledge and new capabilities, which technology will harvest and convert it into effective tools for improving the livelihood and understanding the universe. So what was done by ISRO is going into different orbits, like low Earth orbit between 500 to 1000 kilometers, geostationary orbit at 36,000 kilometers, then Moon, which is at 3.85 lakh kilometers, then Mars, which is at a distance of almost 22 crore kilometers when it is nearest, and farthest 400 or 40 crore kilometers. And in this, we have used different kinds of orbits, an equatorial orbit or a polar orbit, or to go to Moon and Mars, we made use of different category of orbit and traveling starting from Earth, making use of the energy imparted by launch vehicles, and then later by the satellite themselves, we have been able to travel distances up to 600 million kilometers and then reach different places. In fact, all of you will be extremely happy to learn that Chandrayaan 1, which was launched in 2008, was an excellent example of how an international cooperation can be carried out. In fact, though man had landed on the moon, many countries have put probes around the moon and put actually rovers and other things on the surface of the moon. ISRO or India and Chandrayaan 1 gets the credit for discovering water, presence of water molecules and OH molecules on the moon. In fact, just a few days back, you would have seen in the newspaper a news item which also said, using Chandrayaan 1 data, scientists have discovered that rusting process, that means iron rusts, this process also has been detected on Moon. Similarly, Mars orbiter mission, again, was an excellent example of how science and technology can be utilized for doing things very differently. Unlike the advanced countries, we were able to make use of our own launch vehicle capability of PSLV, and using that limited capability, we could build a satellite which traveled from Earth to Mars over a period of about 10 months. And then at the end of traveling almost 600 million kilometers, it actually got inserted into the Mars orbit. This particular activity brought a lot of credit to India and the confidence of India, Indian scientists and technologies grew enormously. What was attempted here was a satellite should be working around Mars for about 6 months. But this September, 2020, September on 24th, we would be completing 6 years of operation. That means what was originally planned for 6 months is completing 6 years of operation. And it has collected many information and many data for scientists to work on and then study, whether it is dust storm occurring on the surface of Mars or the clouds which are present near the various regions of the moon, sorry, Mars, and also the different wavelengths in which this data is collected. All this provides excellent input to the research community of our country. Similarly, like I was trying to tell you earlier, when you look at space from ground, only on a clear sky day, you can see the stars and very clearly galaxies, etc. Because Earth is covered with an atmosphere. But when you go beyond the Earth's atmosphere, you can see very nicely what is happening. And that is the reason why telescopes built are carried on satellites and they go to space, and then from there they make observation. Today we have a satellite what was built called AstroSat, where many academic institutions of our country, researchers and students working, they built instruments like this, what you see, a UV telescope operating in a particular wavelength. Human beings can see light in the wavelength region 400 to 700 nanometers. So below 400 nanometers is the ultraviolet. And in this region, this particular telescope happens to be the world's highest angular resolution. It is better than the best in the world by a factor of 3 times. So because of this capability, today, this particular satellite has made tremendous news because it has detected many things which were not known earlier, whether it is the ultraviolet wings of the butterfly nebula or the polarimetry of Crab pulsar or black spinning of the black holes at very high rotation rates. But more than anything else, recently for the first time, the country was able to demonstrate by a set of scientists that in deep space, whatever signal that emanated 9.3 billion light years. You know that light travels at a speed of 3 lakh kilometers per second. At that speed, if light travels for 1 year, you call it a light year. And if like that, it travels for 9.3 billion years, then that is a distance from which this particular signal has been picked up. That has been possible because of the unique capability of this particular satellite and the instrument. You will also be happy to know that one of our scientists working in IUCA, Indian University, Indira University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics, he led this group, and for the first time in the world that the signal coming from in this particular wavelength region has been detected, and it's a great news for the world. But why I'm emphasizing or stressing this is it is in science and technology, it is never too late. You can always find new things. You need not be feeling that advanced countries have got so many tools, gadgets that we cannot catch up with them. These are examples which shows that if you make up your mind and if you work relentlessly, you can achieve great success. Similarly, in Chandrayaan 2, we have a camera which produces extremely high resolution images. This is one of the best resolution images taken of the moon surface. And then today you have got many such images taken. Again, this orbiter on the moon completed 1 year of operation this month, and using this, a large amount of data has been collected, which will be used by scientists and research community to detect and understand many more things, because the kind of instrument that are there, you also would have heard on moon, there are some regions where sunlight never falls. Even in those regions, you can take pictures using synthetic aperture radars, and we have instruments like that taking images. So with that, it will be possible to detect whether there are ice or water ice, or what are the regions where there are different minerals on moon. And we also have an instrument which can pick up the thermal infrared data, and using that, you can find out about the presence of water and many other minerals and other chemicals, etc. So in this manner, actually this particular image, what you are seeing here is the kind of image you can get over any part of the globe, a video of 1 minute you can take. We have many such satellites today operating in space. And what you are seeing on the left side is the image taken of a volcano when it started spewing some ash. So in this manner, today, what you have seen is India has been able to make use of the space technology, and using the space technology, it has showcased that it is possible to do, even though you are a developing country, you have got resource constraints and you have many other limitations, but if you make up your mind and then keep working, then it's possible for you to achieve great goals and then work for the benefit of the country, contribute to the essential requirements. Today, for example, the satellites what we have built are able to make observations over the Indian subcontinent, not only over Indian subcontinent, but over the entire globe. We can take pictures of any region. We can take digital elevation model information, position information. We can communicate to the remote places, then navigation system. Using all this, today we are able to provide significant amount of capability. But future is actually these where you have to worry about. All of you students have a tremendous opportunity because all this background work exists and you can stand tall on these things. And by virtue of what knowledge you acquire, what skills you acquire, you can make a difference and you can bring in new solutions to the problems the not only India faces, but also the future generations face. India has always shown to the world that life on Earth, we have to look at in its totality. It is many times what happens is science and technology is neutral, but people who make use of it, they have got many times motivations or intentions which are good or bad. And many times knowingly or unknowingly in the process of development, we cause irreparable damage to the environment. And today, because of that, we have to worry about how we can make sure that development continues to happen, but it does not cause damage to ecology. I'll just like to give you an example of what happens when certain developments take place. Way back in the 70s, when we had gone to Russia in one of our trips, we were taken to a place in Volgograd where Russians had built a huge dam. A dam is constructed across the Volga River so that the water which is stored can be used for hydroelectric power generation. And when the Russians built this dam for generating hydroelectric power, very soon they realized that caviar, which is one of the delicacies which Russians used to export and earn huge amount of revenue, the production of the caviar fell in Russia. They realized that because they had built this dam, Solomon fish, which travels thousands of kilometers from ocean to fresh river joints for laying their eggs, their path had been blocked by the dam constructed on the river. So what the fishermen started is, they started picking up fish downstream and leave it upstream so that they could go to their freshwater joints and lay their eggs. The Russians themselves built a fish lift in the dam and transported fish from downstream to upstream. So this shows that when you built a dam, you had actually prevented a natural process of fish traveling upstream to lay their eggs in the freshwater joints. Similarly, Siberian birds, when they travel from the Canada to Siberia, they cross Americas and go. And during that period, today, the buildings and the light that is present in cities like New York actually distracts, and many of these birds go and hit the towers and lose their life. So what Americans started doing is, in specific seasons, they started putting off all the lights so that the path of these birds are not affected. So today you also see how pollution, whether it is due to the various vehicles or due to the renewable resources like coal being burnt and many such things. While we are improving our capabilities for better living, we are also causing damage to ecology. And this is where India and the heritage of India plays a big role. All of you need to remember that we are the longest surviving civilization in the world. And our rishis and munis have shown that to live in a sustainable manner on this planet Earth, we need to treat everything, in this world as part of ourselves, and it's only when we give due respect then how we can survive on this planet Earth without affecting ecology, and then not only we can survive but all forms of life can survive. So it is here that we have a huge challenge, and what the pandemic recently has also shown that a microorganism can cause havoc in the lives of living beings like us, and then it can disrupt us. So if in future human beings have to deal with all these problems, you have to make use of your intellectual capability and find better solutions to the problems we face, solutions which are sustainable, which help not only human beings but all forms of life on planet Earth, and then grow further. So again, let me take this opportunity to wish all of you, just a couple of days late, a great Teachers' Day, and all the students who are participating in this program a great learning experience, and also remind you that you are the people who are going to take this country, our great country, once again to the position where in the yesteryears it was leading in all spheres of life. And I'm sure with your dedicated efforts, we'll be able to see those days coming back. Wish you all a great future. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to talk to you and tell you something about what ISRO has done, what great scientists like Vikram Sarabhai envisioned, and how what was his vision has been brought into reality by thousands of people who have worked relentlessly in our country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, children, any doubt is there? Kindly you come forward. Anybody? Sir,
good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, very good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Sir, one doubt. Sir, suppose if people...
Your voice is not audible.
Sir, unmute it. Please.
Sir, if people start shifting to other planet like Mars or Moon or whatever it may be, according to your opinion, which is very feasible to survive?
See, this is like human nature. See, someday somebody will ask, why do you want to climb Everest? Why do you want to go on top of the Everest? The person simply said, I want to go there because it is there. In the same manner, today you have heard Elon Musk, an entrepreneur who has now built a complete company, and he has already been able to transport the astronauts of America to space station. He is thinking of building vehicles which can take multiple human beings from Earth to Mars and then go there. But actually, if you see in a very long term thinking, planet Earth in our solar system itself, we have seen in this universe many stars dying and they're losing their ability. Our solar system also, one day after billions of years, if it is going to extinct, what will happen to life on Earth? So by that time, I'm sure the life on Earth or people on Earth would have found some way of going to other galaxies or other solar systems and then find ways of surviving there. So it's a human nature. Human beings have exquisite intrinsic capability to think of future and plan for future. So whether right now we are talking a few decades, but people also will start thinking of millions of years ahead also. So it's only a matter of time before human beings go colonize other entities, whether it's moon, planets, etc., etc. So it's a direction in which human beings will continue. But all of this will also happen within the limitations of the economy. He has to first find resources for that, and he has to make the technology suitable. Today, with the chemical technology we have, we require 10 months to travel to Mars. So if somebody has to go to Mars and come back, it's almost like 18 to 20 months. So it's too long a period. But then if technology is found where our speeds of travel, instead of 10 kilometers per second, can become 1,000 kilometers per second, the duration of travel will reduce 100 times or even 1,000 times. So that means people will be start working towards how to build such technological capability of higher speed vehicles, etc. So these are the challenges of the activities that as intrinsic ability of the human beings keep improving. See, today in comparison with what original human beings on this planet, when they were actually able to deal with their daily requirements by hunting or by plants, today you've got telescopes, satellites, rockets, you can travel beyond Earth. So all this is a possibility. Future keeps growing in this fashion.
Sir?
Please.
Yeah.
Please.
Sir?
Go ahead, madam.
सर भारत को अंतरिक्ष विज्ञान के क्षेत्र में विकसित करने के लिए हम छात्रों की क्या भूमिका होनी चाहिए?
छात्रों की भूमिका, जैसे अभी मैंने कहा आपको, अभी इसरो ने और हिंदुस्तान ने विक्रम साराभाई का जो विजन था उसके हिसाब से अभी एक स्तर पे लेके आया. अभी हमारे पास अपने ही उड़ान करने के लिए रॉकेट्स है, सैटेलाइट्स है, उपग्रह है. उपग्रह में बहुत सारे उपकरण बनाने का हमारे पास तरीका है, जैसे आपने देखा एस्ट्रोसैट और दूसरे साइंटिफिक इंस्ट्रूमेंट से हम नए नए शोध कर रहे हैं. और उसके अलावा पृथ्वी में भी अलग अलग उपयोग के लिए काम कर रहे हैं. मगर अभी भी हमारे देश में और मानव को पृथ्वी में रहने के लिए बहुत सारे तकलीफें हैं और दिक्कतें हैं. वो दिक्कतों को कैसे सुलझाने का और उस वो प्रॉब्लम्स को कैसे सॉल्व करने का, ये हमेशा ये प्रॉब्लम्स रहेगा. ये प्रॉब्लम्स में अगर हमको देखना है, दो तरफ कर सकते हैं. अभी छात्र, जैसे आप कह रहे हैं, आप स्टूडेंट्स हैं, इसरो का भी वेबसाइट है एक भुवन करके. भुवन में आप जैसे गूगल में देखते हैं, भुवन में भी हमारा जो उपग्रहों से एकत्रित किया हुआ माहिती अलग अलग हमारे पूरे भारत वर्ष के और पृथ्वी के भी अलग अलग माहिती 40 साल से क्या हो रहा है, कैसे बदल रही है. अभी अभी मैंने एक वीडियो में आपको दिखाया, हिमालय पे ग्लेशियर मेल्ट होती है. वो ग्लेशियर जैसे मेल्ट होता रहता है, पानी का लेक बढ़ता है और ये लेक कभी आगे एक आपदा को आपदा का कारण बन सकता है. अगर हम ये माहिती को परखे और उससे आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस, मशीन लर्निंग, ये तरीकों से उसको इस्तेमाल करके नया नया नॉलेज बना निकाले और वो नॉलेज से अर्ली वार्निंग के लिए और दूसरे दूसरे कामों के लिए लाने के लिए हम काम कर सकते हैं. एक और उदाहरण देना चाहता हूँ. कपल दो तीन साल पहले उत्तराखंड में एक बहुत बड़ा आपदा हुआ. वो आपदा में छात्रों के साथ और टीचर्स के साथ मिलके वहाँ पे इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ रिमोट सेंसिंग जो है मोबाइल्स में एक ऐप बनाया. वो मोबाइल के जरिए वो लोगों ने जहाँ जहाँ वो आपदा के वजह से जो तकलीफ हुआ था उसका चित्रण लिया, मोबाइल कैमरा से पिक्चर्स लिए, वो सब पिक्चर्स को रिलीफ एजेंसियों को पहुंचाया. बहुत जल्दी के समय में, लेस देन अ कपल ऑफ डेज, दी डिजास्टर रिलीफ एजेंसी को इतने सारे माहिती मिल गया, उनको प्लानिंग में उनको फायदा हुआ. ऐसे बहुत सारे, अभी हैदराबाद में हमारा एक सेंटर है, उसमें छात्रों को वहां जाके ये जो पूरा सुविधा है, कंप्यूटर सिस्टम है और डेटा है, वो डेटा को यूज करके वहां पे काम करने के लिए भी प्रावधान है और उसको यूज करके अलग अलग सोल्यूशन निकालने के लिए काम कर सकते हैं. बहुत सारे काम एनालिसिस का करना बाकी है, डेटा जनरेट करना एक काम है, वो डेटा को इस्तेमाल करके उसको सॉल्यूशन के रूप में लाना दूसरा काम है। आप जैसे छात्रों का रिसर्चर्स का काम ये रहेगा कि कैसे हम ये सब माहिती इस्तेमाल करके हमारे आडलित वर्ग को और गवर्नेंस में जो है उनको माहिती पहुंचाए, कैसे हम काम कर सकते हैं, कैसे हम सॉल्यूशंस निकाल सकते हैं।
थैंक यू सर।
एक्सक्यूज मी सर,
प्लीज गो अहेड
सर। मायसेल्फ लिखित वर्धन फ्रॉम जेएनवी बैंगलोर अर्बन सर। I have a doubt, sir. Can humans travel in light speed in future, or any space agencies in our world is able to do that, sir?
Like I pointed out, today the technological capability that is there of transporting material is something like 10 to 20 kilometers per second. And the speed of light, what you are talking, is 3 lakh kilometers per second. So today, technology does not exist of taking any significant amount of mass at that speed. If actually it's a work which in progress, research, lot of thinking is going on how we can build systems which can travel or which can transport things at higher and higher speed. As of today, such a capability does not exist, but it does not mean tomorrow it may not be there. So work has to be done, and only when higher and higher speed traveling becomes possible, the extra long distances, like you saw, today we are able to see signals emanating from 9 billion light years away. So what future holds for us is yet to be visualized.
Good afternoon, sir.
Sir? Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, is there any project or the provision is made by the ISRO for to launch a satellite? Because now our neighbors, they are mostly, they are giving a statement, they launch a missile which can reach any part of India. So we have anything that plan, future plan of an anti-missile that can be loaded on a satellite so that it will save our country, sir?
Actually, your voice is not very clear. Maybe you have to speak a little louder.
Sir? Yes, sir.
Please go ahead.
No. Sir, now please repeat it. Audible, sir?
Your voice is not very clear. It's very feeble. Maybe you can increase the volume.
Okay, sir. Now, Bhaskar, sir. Okay, Kiriya.
Okay, sir. I want to know that any program in ISRO is going on to launch an anti-missile through satellite so that our neighboring countries always threaten us that we have a capability of striking any part of an India.
Okay. See, actually, Department of Space and space activity is basically make use of space technology for providing solutions and to the problems we face. And this particular activity, what you are talking about, forms in the domain of defense organizations. And what we do is build satellites, build capabilities, and from space and space technology, how to bring in various solutions. So we work on this aspect, and the missiles and anti-satellite systems, they are actually being developed by worked upon by the defense systems.
Actually, because even the Japan earlier, they don't have this defense capabilities. I mean, now they started, they changed their constitution a little bit.
Yeah, correct. Because when the, after the World War, the other countries forced Japan to not spend on their defense. So because of that, they were under constraint. And then as the situations change, as the geopolitical scenarios change, every country has to defend itself. So for defending itself, you need to do many things. So these become part of that.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Sir, one small doubt, sir. I think through remote sensing, you can find out the presence of fish, everything. Is it possible to find out the presence of minerals in the seabed?
Yeah, see, Actually, minerals, yeah, remote sensing basically observes from the surface what it is getting, and what penetration it can do is actually few meters, if depending on microwave wavelength. So depending on the wavelength of electromagnetic radiation you are using, you can go up to certain depths. But minerals, what is actually being done is, if you make use of what is called hyperspectral imaging, even on the surface, there are certain features which change the nature reflection. Many plants, if there is copper present in that or a particular mineral present, the plant spectrum changes. So similarly, surface color changes. So one is on the surface, by making use of hyperspectral imaging, you can detect. But if you go very close to the ocean, what you can see when you go to slightly the shorter wavelengths, little bit of penetration is possible, but very deep penetration is not possible. And the kind of things that can be done from space will have limitation when you get into the ocean. Now, fish itself, how it is detected is based on what is called water leaving radiance. That means the kind of electromagnetic radiation which comes out of the surface of water. This is measured in different wavelengths, and based on that, you identify chlorophyll, and through chlorophyll, what is the food chain of fish, and through that, you identify where fish is. So you have thermal fronts as well as this, plus wind vector. All of this goes into prediction. So remote sensing is the art of making observations and through models, identifying and understanding what is happening.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, it is again heard that the presence of pure uranium under the earth can be located or identified by these remote sensing. Is it the statement is correct, sir?
Now, like I said, a lot of research is being done how to detect based on what you are observing from the surface. So actually, a lot of experiments happen, a lot of different activities are done, not only from satellite, but also aircraft carrying specific techniques, even magnetic observations, or by observing in different frequencies of electromagnetic radiation, and by carrying sensors which can penetrate, like today you have a ground penetrating radar. Similarly, there are aircrafts which can carry some specific sensors. So actually, these are all different areas in which people are working. And I myself will not be able to give you an answer whether it is possible to detect thorium or not. But in principle, what remote sensing can do, I can tell.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, now, any more questions, children? Okay, sir. Sir, it is really thrilling to know the achievements of our country in space and beyond. But it is highly thrilling to see the applications of our space programs in day-to-day life of a common man. It's up to you all, sir. You people achieved more or less everything in space program for our country, that too comparably in a very short period. Now we are confident that our country is not at all inferior to any advanced country in any kind of indigenous space programs. We are highly indebted to people like you, sir. Now I invite my Honorable Deputy Commissioner, who is sitting in Hyderabad, sir, to propose the formal vote of thanks to you, sir. Please, sir, over to you. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Kannan.
Yes, sir.
It was such an amazing experience for all of us. Professor A.S. Kiran Kumar, an authority in the space science and technology, yes, is the right person for the right cause today to stimulate and inspire JNV students towards STEM education, the purpose for which the Vigyan Jyoti program is launched by Department of Science and Technology. Within a very short time, it's only because of the versatility of Professor, he could bring such difficult subjects, such difficult concepts very close to the minds of small school children. Sir, the authority and the spontaneity with which you have spoken on the vital aspects of space science and technology is definitely going to be a source of inspiration for all Navodaya students. Today, I'm very happy to place before you that more than, across the country, the students have got accessibility to your message and blessing. And this is how we have taken advantage of this pandemic, and we have been arranging series of blessings by eminent scientists like you. I thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time. And in a very short time, the most difficult areas, the historical perspective in stimulating is really stimulating and inspiring in the areas of science, space science and technology. And the other areas that we have touched upon, the evolution of launch vehicles, launch vehicle technology has been very, very inspiring. From where we started and where we are today, the credit goes to all the scientists of your caliber and the dedication and the commitment with which this has been run. And the rare pictures of a satellite mission that you have shown us is really amazing. And it would have definitely taken the children to the realms of space science and technology. The applications and advantage of space science is explained in very simple words, and it's very inspiring. And what you have touched upon, science as the source of new knowledge and new possibilities, is what is the message that we are all striving to make children understand for the sustainable development of our country. The blessing and the key and the final message that you have given us, that it is only through sustainable development, which is the philosophy of Indian culture and heritage, is what is so inspiring to us. And in a very comprehensive manner, you have given a holistic picture towards the STEM education. And we are really indebted to you for sparing your valuable time with us. And this is only a beginning for a better a course of action, sir. We would like to have continued association with you. And there are many JNVs which are nearer to you. And definitely we will take support of you to take you to some of the JNVs and to address the students. Thank you very much, sir, for sparing your valuable time. Thank you, Mr. Kannan, for arranging such a wonderful.
Thank you.